I didn't really think that my story mattered until this year. I spent my whole life thinking that my story didn't matter. And it's not even that I thought that there was a real story. I just didn't think that it was anything worth telling. And it's really interesting because now I'm creating an entire podcast based off of my story. So hey everyone, my name is Fareedah and this is the story behind the Accidental Error podcast. It's really weird to be talking about this because for someone who didn't value the impact that I could have on the world, it's interesting to be doing so much work based off of impact. But I always knew I had impact. I was always a very, very confident person. I grew up with a lot of immense amount of confidence. My mother doesn't know where it came from. I don't know where it came from. It's all just a mystery right now. And we're just rolling with it. We're all just accepting the reality of it and rolling with it. And it's a beautiful thing right now because I'm realizing that the impact that my story has and the story that the guests that I'll be interviewing in the next coming episodes will have is really, really huge. And the reason why I am here where I am today is because of other people's stories. It's because of other people's resilience. It's because of other people doing what they can to reach the heights that they've reached today. And I'm in no means living the dream, but I really believe that every single part of my life is a dream, if you know what I mean, right? We still have goals. There are things that I want to reach, but every single day I'm so grateful for where I am and how far I came. Because years ago I was a black girl that walked into a classroom in Saudi Arabia, and I had no idea what would happen to me, right? And the big question that most people ask me is, girl, why the hell were you in Saudi Arabia? Like, this is the most random thing ever, right? Like, why were you there? And it all started when I was 8 years old and my father got a job in Saudi. He was in the tech field. And if any of you heard me on Cisco's podcast, I talked about how he had a tech job and he had a lot of like Cisco books that he would bring home and I used to read them. So that was my first introduction to tech. His love for tech and his understanding of tech is what brought him to Saudi Arabia, brought me to Saudi Arabia. My mother to Saudi Arabia also introduced me to the tech field, which of course, as you all know, is the online security movement, is the safe kids movement, is helping mothers protect their kids online. That's what I do professionally. But that was my introduction to it. And so I moved to Saudi Arabia at 8 years old because of his tech job, me and my mother. And when I first landed in the plane, like I obviously went through a plane. I mean, we weren't about to go across anything. We were about to go in the sky. We were not in the waters, but yeah, I'm going to stop silliness. I landed there and it was like sunset, right? And it was very, very warm. It was such a beautiful air about it. It was so, so peaceful. And I was so excited to be there because as a Muslim, we learned about Saudi Arabia in terms of Mecca. And if anyone doesn't know Mecca is a holy city for Muslim people. It's where a mosque is there. It's really beautiful, serene, and peaceful. So I felt like this is a Muslim country and this is going to be a really awesome experience. So that's how I physically got into Saudi Arabia. And I spent about 8 years of my life in Saudi Arabia. And I went to school there as well. When I first went to Saudi Arabia, I went to what is called like an international school. So I went to Minarat Riyadh. If anyone knows that, if you've been to Minarat, let me know. And I landed there and I went to like the English section. So it was just the section of the school where most of the studies were in English. And then we had, I believe, we had French class. Yeah, so everyone basically knew French after a couple of years of being in the school. So we had English and then French as a second language, because I know here in the U.S. many people take Spanish. So it's similar to that, right? And that was my first introduction there. There was a couple of Black Americans in that school in the international section. But what happened was my parents really didn't want me to be in Saudi Arabia and not know the language. They're like, if we came all the way to a whole different continent, my daughter is about to know a different language. You know, she's not going to just know one language. She's going to need to know a different language. And I'm really grateful for them for that, because without that, I wouldn't have, you know, known Arabic. I would have just been in like the English section and not really knowing, even though there are many people who stayed in the English section and still knew Arabic because of their friends or family members or whatever it was. But nevertheless, I'm really happy that I got the chance to know Arabic. So they switched me from the English section to the Arabic section of the school. So the school was like split down two sections. And this was an all-girls school in this part of it. So they always think of it like a university, right? And there was like a boys section of university, girls section, and each section had the English section and the Arabic section. So there's like four parts of the schools, so to speak, right? And so obviously I was in the girls section, and I moved from the English language one to the Arabic language one. And that was when I became the first, or really the only Black American girl to walk into that classroom, at least in that year. It was a really interesting time period because I was really, I mean, like I said, I'm a really, really confident person. I was just born with this immense amount of confidence. But that really, really affected my confidence. And it became a really good thing because not only did it humble me, but it gave me an understanding of how the world really works. And I knew before that my skin color was a big thing. I remember my mom telling me a story where this was back in the U.S. when I was here. And around like the DMV area, that's where I was born. And I came to her one day and I was like, you know, I want to be beautiful like you. This is essentially what I said. I may be saying it wrong, but I told her that I wanted to be beautiful like her because she has like lighter skin. And that was the moment where she said she didn't even realize that we had different skin colors, you know, and that really, really scared her that I was thinking that way. I think I was about 4 years old, and it really scared her for me to be talking about that when I was so little. And so she wanted to, or she did pull me out of the school that I was in because she didn't like that was already on my mind. And that really was a heartbreaking moment for her. And so, yes, of course, you know, I knew about skin color and the differences of it. And I was already internalizing that my darker skin was less beautiful than other people's skin color. I was already internalizing that, but going to Saudi Arabia really amplified that in a extremely negative way. And I had to heal from that. It was a lot of, you know, like I said, this is a part of my healing journey. And so when I walked into that classroom, I was one of the only dark-skinned people. Now, there were other dark-skinned people, like dark-skinned Arabs, but no one was American. So when I came in with my dark skin self and my little kinky hair, and I walked in that classroom and I said I was American, they looked at me like I had two heads, like, girl, what? You ain't American? We're watching High School Musical, we're watching all these things, I don't know what else they're watching. Like a real American girl has blonde hair, has blue eyes, is, you know, the traditional pretty, is really thin, even though I was thin as well, so I have, you know, thin privilege, but it just does not look like you, right? And so they didn't believe me. They thought I was joking, they thought I was kidding, and they really were like, no, you're African, but you're really trying to be American. But I was just never accepted in who I was. So it made me question a lot of things about myself. But also, like I said in the first episode, is that I was ostracized because of my skin color. So people wouldn't sit next to me. They would throw things at me. They would spit at me. They wouldn't want to touch me. And then other people found me really fascinating when I walked in the classroom. You know, they were like, wow, your skin is really interesting. So they would just take my hand and they would like run their hands on my skin because they thought, oh, this is so fascinating. Like, you're just so dark and, oh, you don't get sunburn. It was just like weird things like that would happen. And it's really interesting because you would think, well, because there are other Black people who were dark-skinned Arabs in the classroom, they would be friends with you. But what's interesting is that they actually came to be the biggest bullies. And for me, the reason I felt like they were the biggest bullies, not because, I mean, they definitely were, but is because before I walked in the classroom, they were being bullied. And now that a new girl came in, it was being bullied as well, instead of being on my side, because I was being bullied for similar things that they were in terms of the skin color conversation. They thought it better if they could get higher status, you know, higher popularity with some of the girls if they were to agree with them on my lack of intelligence or my lack of beauty because of my skin color. And so they join in the fun with that. And I believe that hurt a lot. That hurt the most. Of course it hurt a lot, but it hurt the most because I thought they would be on my side because we're going through similar things, but they became the worst of them. And they used to, it was just really, really terrible. I remember talking to one of the girls, just asking her why she was being so mean. It just didn't make any sense. I'm like, you're going through the same thing. And then she just looked at me and she was just like, you and I are not the same. And it was just like, it was like a disgust look in her face. And I had to figure out my own way. And this is where the understanding space came in. I had to figure out, how can I survive in this environment and still thrive at the same time? Because I don't want to just survive. I want to make sure I'm thriving. And it was a really interesting time period for me. And I had to look at other people and see, okay, what are other people going through as well? Like, what are other people being bullied for? And so many people were bullied for different things. So some people were bullied because they didn't come from like the same family or tribe, or they were fat, or they were ugly, you know, to other people's eyes. And or people who had low self-esteem. So they may have been, you know, part of the popular crowd or whatever that means, but they just did not have a lot of confidence, or they were going through their own trauma, so it made them a little bit weird or different or quiet. And I took all of them and we kind of created our own group within the school, and we started talking together and sitting next to each other and comforting each other and just having a really beautiful time together and healing through things. And so I would just, you know, come up with ways that we could all better deal with the bullies. One of my biggest things that I told myself to go through it, and I would share with the group because we were all in it together, was to ignore them. Because when you ignored them, the whole thing was that they wanted you to be their entertainment. And I understood that them going against me, how I look or my background or my story, or even going as far as to say that I wasn't Muslim because I couldn't be Muslim as a Black American and I couldn't be American or whatever. It was an up and down, and I just realized it wasn't about me. It was about them, and it was about their lack of understanding of the world. Or maybe they really did understand the world, right? Because we see this all over the place. But it was really, they wanted some entertainment, and if I didn't give them something to get satisfied with, they would stop. And the bullying did really come to pretty much a halt. I mean, I had certain experiences. I probably will talk a little bit more about that later in terms of people feeling like I stole things because I was Black. So if something went missing in the classroom, I had an incident where we were having like a classroom party inside our school and everyone had to bring like a snack. So I brought something, everyone else brought something, and there's this girl who brought a whole like host of bags of chips, like just different brands. It's a lot of chips, and she stored it one place, but for some reason it got misplaced, and so the whole world around the school became that someone stole the chip bags. And they all looked at me and they're like, well, obviously she stole it because she was Black. The principal got involved and they're just like, you know, where is the bag of chips? Like, why would you steal these chip bags? And I'm just sitting here like, no, I didn't. I don't know where they went. And so no one believes me, and they thought I was pulling a trick and that I wanted to take people's food. And so it got all the way to the principal's office, and it became a really, really big thing. And that was really traumatic for me because no one was believing me. And it could, you know, potentially affect many, many different things in the school if I'm known as someone who's a thief. But thankfully, I was able to, you know, go home to my mother and let her know this was happening. And one of her students or someone she knew had some big pool, meaning that they knew who she was. She came from a really, really big influential family, and she stood by my side and said, nope, that's not Fareedah's character. She wouldn't do that. She didn't do it. We'll find the chip bag. This is not like, she didn't steal anything. She's not a stealer. And because this woman was very, very influential in the Arab community, I can't remember if it was a royal family member or not. It was just someone who was really, really big. And because she came to my side, I was able to get that off my name, and And the principal kind of backed down and they're like, okay, well, we'll try to figure out where this thing was. They eventually, after a couple hours, did find the chip bag, and it ended up being that the girl who had the chip bag misplaced the chip bag. I don't know if she intentionally misplaced it. I don't know that until this day, but you know, there's just different things that people try to do in middle school to like try to sabotage you. But thankfully it didn't work. Thankfully I had a beautiful Arab lady who came to my side who said, no, I'm not tolerating this BS. She did not do that. And it's really people like her that allowed me to have some really beautiful experiences. And this is an example of what I want to do across this podcast, is because while I'm going to talk about stories that were traumatic for me, a lot of stories that involve different people, especially because I was in Saudi Arabia, it's going to involve a lot of racism from the Arab side and the Arab community. I did want to mention this story because this was one of the prime examples of someone who was very, very big and influential, a part of a huge, beautiful family in the Arab community that stood up for me and made sure that my time there was less miserable. And there are many friends that I created during that time period, whether it's inside my school or outside, or even till this day, that are really beautiful people that are fighting against racism and a lot of trauma. And in many, every single community, every single ethnicity, every single type of person, we all have groups of people that have given us trauma. And so in no way, shape, or form am I going to say that this is the only story and this is the only narrative. It is very, very complex. However, I can say my story, and I can say it without, you know, mincing any of my words, but telling you the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help me God, right? And this has become a part of my life and a part of my story and a part of the impact that I want to create, that we all have something that we're going through. And the entire point of this is to bring us together, for us to heal together, for us to create safe spaces offline and online. And that is the story of how I got into Saudi Arabia and a little snippet of what I went through in school. And like you can tell, it was overall one of the most beautiful periods of my entire life. And I wouldn't take it back for the world. It made me who I am today. It showed me that I've been creating safe/understanding spaces for my entire life. And it's something that I'll continue to do, and something that's within my heart and soul. And it was such a beautiful period. And like my mother loves to say, is it was both a blessing and a challenge. It was a challenge because of the trauma that I just talked about. I didn't go into too many details, but just enough. And it was beautiful, and it was a blessing, because without that, I wouldn't be creating this podcast today. Without that, I probably wouldn't be talking about the understanding space and the online security movement or the safe kids movement or the things that I do in tech or in security or with kids. None of this would be possible without those experiences. None of us would be here without those traumatic experiences. And at the end of the day, they turn into something greater than we can ever imagine. And if we're able to tell our stories and use our voices to create impact, that's what matters the most. And that's the one thing I want to do. I don't want to leave this world without creating a positive impact. I don't want you to leave this world without creating a positive impact. And this is the fun look of my life and why I created this podcast, how I got to Saudi Arabia. And this will give you an introduction to all of the rest of the stories that I will tell. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. And as always, if you want to connect with me, if you want to say something about the podcast, if you would like to see a guest, if you have any recommendations, you can message me on Instagram, DM me at CyberFareedah, and I cannot wait to see you soon.